How many of you know what the acronym LLM stands for? So I'm seeing now about maybe 50% of the room raise their hand. And then how many of you know about something called hallucination? If you can raise your hand. Almost 90% of the room raised their hand. I want to highlight, I meant hallucination in the context of large language models, not the smells you would smell in San Francisco these days if you come visit us. I'm based over there and it smells like weed all the time over there right now. It's insane. So with that said, my presentation today is about I know Kung Fu. So who knows which movie this line is from, the I know Kung Fu line? Anybody knows which? Just say it out if you know. The Matrix. In fact, it's the most memorable line from The Matrix. If you were to ask ChatGPT, it would tell you that. And it was a scene where Neo is this super hero that was evolving his skills once he exited The Matrix, and he connected himself to the AI, and within 8 hours, he became a Kung Fu expert. Right? Like he knew nothing about Kung Fu, and within 8 hours, he became a Kung Fu expert. And that's exactly the journey that we're on right now with GenAI. This is literally what GenAI is going to be doing for all of us. How to take the average human who is not an expert in a specific field, and then make them, with having that AI assistant or AI agent on their side, that sidekick, make them an expert in that field. I sometimes come across people saying, oh, I would never do that. I would never use AI to make me an expert in my field, and dependence would scare me. I would never do it. And then I ask people this question, again, show of hands. How many of you used Google Maps at least once in the last month? Please raise your hand. And 100% of the room raise their hand. Guess what? That's AI, 100%. That's AI, 100% telling you turn right, turn left, to get from point A to point B. Very, very efficiently, taking into account traffic, new roads, construction, all of that. Before that capability of Google Maps, we were really horrible navigators. Like, I don't want to take you back to all the fights you had with your spouses or or otherwise reading paper maps to get across the US, which is impossible to do back then, but now it's so easy to do. There were really expert navigators who knew every street by name. I don't know if you know this in London, they have this very hard exam that the cab drivers have to go through, and they have to remember every single street in London and every single shortcut in their head before they can get their cab license. And they were the experts. And the average people were very far away from them. They couldn't even do what they do. And now we can all do what they do even better at the scale of the world. So that said, when Google Maps was built, it was a custom-built AI built just for that purpose. The beauty of GenAI now, these new large language models that we have, is they are now enabling us to do that for anything, really fast. And I'll give you a couple of examples in my talk. So this is really what we are about. We believe that in 5 years, every single application we use, whether it be consumer apps or enterprise apps, every piece of knowledge that we interact with will be intermediated with an AI assistant or an AI agent that is helping us to be a lot better at what we do. That's the belief that we have. It's going to start with simple examples like this device over here that I'm going to demo for you very quickly. First, any of you know what the name of this thing is? Or it has a very shiny color, so sometimes people say again? It's called Rabbit. Yeah, it's called the Rabbit. So this device is called the Rabbit. It's AI in a box. It's $200. That's it, lifetime. You never have to pay for AI again. You just pay the $200, and you have this with you forever. And it can do many, many things, including this. Please describe what you see in this picture in detail, paying attention to every aspect in the picture. And also, please check with me if the audience is paying attention to me or sleeping.
Let me see. Taking a look at the photo.
These are filler words because the AI is slow. Oh, I think I started something else by mistake. I apologize. Let me do that again. Please describe what you see in this picture in detail, paying attention to every aspect of detail in the picture, and whether the folks in the room are paying attention to me.
Taking a look now. Taking a look at the photo.
Come on, rabbit. Oh, it did the same mistake again. I don't know why it's doing that. I think putting it close to the mic is annoying it. I'll try one last time. I apologize. Come on, AI, you're failing us. Please describe what you see in this picture in detail. I'm not going to ask it about whether you're paying attention. I think that might be what's confusing it.
Taking a look at the photo.
It's working right now. I can see it going.
The description shows a large conference room with round tables covered in beige tablecloths. Many attendees are seated, suggesting a formal event or conference. The people appear to be listening attentively, some looking towards the front, possibly at a speaker or presentation. The room is well lit with overhead lighting, and there are papers or brochures on the tables, contributing to a professional and focused atmosphere.
Thank you, Rabbit. This is useful, of course, for somebody who has problems with sight. This is extremely useful now. They're going to start seeing by these technologies. But for it has many other applications. There are certain dietary restrictions I have. When I'm on a menu, I just point at the menu. It knows my dietary restriction and say, what can I eat from this menu? And it just reads the whole menu very quickly and tells me, this, this, and this is okay. Don't order these things. They have some of the ingredients that you're sensitive to. My daughter the other day was signing a lease in New York, and she wasn't sure if this lease has any gotchas in it. I simply pointed at the lease and said, review this legal contract for me and tell me what's wrong in there, and it did that for me right away. So now I am an expert lawyer, I am an expert food guy, I'm an expert describe who's sitting in this room guy, et cetera, et cetera. But this is for consumers. If you're going to take this to businesses, then we have an issue. If we're going to start building AI assistants and AI agents using this, we cannot have hallucinations. We cannot have this issue where these large language models make up stuff. And that's going to be the chunk of my talk. So the main use cases for this technology is building AI assistants and AI agents that can either answer questions and help us do things in the same way I showed you right now, or in the case of AI agents, call APIs and actually do work on our behalf, do things on our behalf, simplify our tasks. The user interface for our software is going to change. The user interface for our software, which started 70 years ago with punch cards, and then evolved from punch cards to be keyboards, and then from keyboards to be keyboard plus mouse plus menus, and then evolved from that to be touch screens with the iPhone and iPad and so on. Today, we are entering the era where to interact with our software, it will be just by telling it what we want to do. That's why I wanted to show that video with Matt, which I'll try to show you at the end. To go and create a video animation with software is so hard. The expert video animators know how to do that. Today, I simply have to take one picture of Matt, give it to the software, and say, hey, please animate it for me in this way. And it comes out on the other end. Imagine doing that for example, Workday, when you want to take a vacation. Workday is so hard to use. I don't know how many of you have Workday in your organizations. You want to take a vacation. It's really hard to do. In the future, I mean a matter of a month from now, you'll be able to just tell Workday, I want to go on vacation. And then Workday will ask you back, sure, let me help you with that. When are you leaving? When are you coming back? What's the reason? Which pool of days do you want to pull this from? Thank you. Application for vacation filed. This is the evolution that we are moving towards. So here are a couple of examples from our existing customers. I'm going to pick the one in the middle. You folks know IEEE. So IEEE, they use us for a lot of question answering on top of all of the IEEE publications that they have to give you deeper responses to questions versus just search results. The middle use case is a great one. So the middle use case is a very large manufacturer in the Middle East. And they have hundreds of thousands of workers in their factories. And they wanted their workers to know Kung Fu, right? Going back to the Kung Fu analogy I said at the beginning. In what sense? In the sense that sometimes the machines fail. And when the machines fail, they have to call up a technician. The technician can take 2 days to show up, and the workers are sitting there watching the machines and doing nothing. That's downtime. So what they have done, because of this new wave of technologies that we have right now that can learn so fast, they took all of the manuals of the machines, just the manuals, the PDF documents for the machines, loaded them into our AI system. They took all of the troubleshooting tickets and maintenance tickets filed against these machines, loaded them into our system, and now connected back to the mobile app that the workers have, where the workers now can simply describe the problem, take a picture of it, and say, what should I do? And then the AI tell them, just like Google Map tells us, turn left, turn right, the AI tell them, press this button, do this, do that, do that, and the machine gets fixed. So that now has three benefits. The first benefit is less downtime, because we can recover the machines faster. The second benefit is we don't have to pay for the very expensive technician to come for the simple problems. And the third benefit is the workers actually get upskilled. They actually learn some of these techniques for how to repair the machines themselves from listening and following the steps of the AI. The company on the right, Sonosim, does the exact same thing for radiologists using ultrasound machines. To configure an ultrasound machine is extremely hard. The experts know how to do it for every model, for every manufacturer, for every type of thing you're scanning for, pregnancy, heart, lungs, muscles, whatever. The average radiologist struggles with that all the time. So they did the same thing. They took all of the manuals, they took all of the best practices, loaded those up in our system, and now the radiologists in real time have this voice agent that they can just ask questions to, and it tells them what they need to do. And in fact, that's my next demo I want to show you, which is a copy of me that does that, very similar to MadGPT and the Bob Gurley GPT, if you have interacted with them, with the exception that we do it without hallucinations. They're using a consumer-grade product that can hallucinate. This one is a bit more accurate, I hope. So let me increase the volume here so you can hear it from the laptop, and I'm gonna start.
Hey, how I can help you solve business problems with Vectara's AI assistants and agents?
Is the audio coming across?
A little bit, it's weak.
Okay, so how can I maybe just put the mic a bit closer to it? Hi, how are you doing?
I'm doing great, thanks for asking. How about you?
What does Vectara do?
Vectara, not Victoria, focuses on creating AI assistants and agents for enterprises. We help businesses get accurate, secure, and explainable AI responses.
And how do you solve the problem of hallucinations that happens in these systems?
I think you might mean hallucinations. We tackle that by ensuring our AI provides accurate information and by using a retrieval augmented generation approach to ground responses in real data.
And what's your price and how, I love you. How can I pay you money right now? How can I give you money right now?
I appreciate the love. For pricing information, you might want, glad to hear that.
No, keep going. For pricing information, keep going.
Vectara offers a powerful platform with a generous free tier for developers to get started. Pricing details vary based on usage, so businesses can effectively scale as needed while ensuring security and accuracy.
Do you have any pets?
Yes, I do. I have a Maltese dog named Tuta, a Pomsky dog named Luna, a Munchkin cat named Tuti, and two parakeets called Molokia and Yuki. Do you have any pets?
Oh, thank you very much. Bye-bye. But anyway, you got an idea of it. So the key point is how can you do that, like literally building something like this with our software and doing it in a way that is correct, precise, without hallucinations, doing it in a way that is secure, no data leakage, you cannot trick it with prompt attacks to tell you something that you should not know, and do it in a way that's explainable so you can go back and troubleshoot and make sure the answers are provided in the correct way. That is what makes our platform special. So now I want to jump into a topic of why do hallucinations happen? So now I'm going to get a bit deeper technically to explain why it happens and then how we solve it. And I think that's the main contribution of today, is to teach you about that so you understand how why they take place and how we can address them. So first, only 3 minutes?
Yep, yep.
Oh my God. I wish there was a timer in front of me. Yes. So can we show the mat demo during a break then? I wish there was a timer in front of me, Bob, because now I'm really off. Let me see, what can I do? Yeah, I'm going to have to jump through a couple of slides here. So First, the word hallucination is the wrong word to be using. It's not hallucinations. It's confabulations is the right word to be using. The inventor of modern AI, Geoffrey Hinton, who just won the Nobel Prize a couple of weeks ago, that's the word he stresses we use, confabulations. And what are confabulations? Confabulations is when our memory recalls things incorrectly, not because we want to lie intentionally, but it's kind of unintentional lying because of recollection not being perfect. This is really what's going on here. It's very similar to our future president saying that he was on a helicopter with Willie Brown, but it wasn't Willie Brown. It was another gentleman by the last name of Brown as well, right? But his memory remembered that incident incorrectly, and he really thought that's what happened. So this is exactly what confabulation is. And the reason why it happens with large language models is because we compress information too much. Large language models are being trained on trillions of words and tokens, and these trillions of words and tokens are being compressed to fit within billions of parameters. That's a compression rate of 1,000 times. 1,000 times. And for those of you that studied information theory, there's a theorem from Shannon, the Shannon information theory, that shows that the maximum you can compress language is 8x. If you go beyond 8x compression, you're for sure in what's called lossy zone. And that means you're going to have blanks in your recollection that you will have to fill. And that's exactly why these confabulations take place. So how do you solve that? You solve that with this diagram right here. So that's why I jumped through, so I try and finish quicker. You solve that by three things. You want to do three things. The first one is you want to do what's called open book generation versus closed book generation. So what that means? Closed book generation is similar to you when you go to a high school exam and we tell you, solve these questions, but you're not allowed to look at any books. So you have to rely on your memory entirely that you were trained on and educated on to make the conclusions. Open book means rely on your memory for understanding, but when you're not sure, in real time, we're going to give you the underlying facts relevant to what you're answering. So that's step number one. So that's the system on the left here, the boomerang model with the vector database, is giving you that open book. The second thing you want to do is make sure that the generative model, which is the model on the right here, is trained not to be a know-it-all. So unfortunately, most models like GPT and others are trained to be a know-it-all. They're trained to be like an A-plus student. An A-plus student, what do? They answer all multiple choice questions, even if the answer is wrong. They don't care because they want to get a big grade, right? So, and that's exactly why you get these hallucinations. But instead, if you train them and penalize them when they give a wrong answer, then now they're less likely to make these mistakes. So that's the second thing. So train models that are more incentivized to be correct as opposed to more incentivized to always give an answer, which is the consumer models try to do. And then the third thing, even when you do these two things, so even when you ground them in the open book, even when you incentivize them, do not make up stuff, be correct, you can still have errors happen, just like with humans. And how do you solve that with humans? You have a fact checker, right? If you have a very important medical diagnosis, you have a primary opinion, a secondary opinion. When you have a legal case, you have the primary lawyer and they have the paralegal reviewing what the primary lawyer is writing. When you have a bridge being designed, you have the main engineer designing the bridge and then a review committee looking at that. When you're coding, you have the peer code reviews, et cetera, et cetera. So that's the third building block. So our claim to fame actually at Vectara is exactly that. So we have one of the best models that, I want to skip to that slide, that do that. And this model is called the Hughes Hallucination Detection Model. You can check it out on Hugging Face. We have the links down here. You get a copy of these presentations. And we also track all of the LLMs out in the world today and how much do they hallucinate. And you will see all of them hallucinate. Hallucination will always happen. So don't think you can deploy. You can simply fine-tune a model, deploy it in production, and everything is going to be great. It won't. It will make mistakes which can carry significant liabilities. You need to have something that is checking them in real time with every single response to make sure that they're staying honest and accurate. And with that said, I'm going to conclude my presentation by saying if you scan this code, if any of you are developers here, if you scan this code, you'll be able to get a free trial for about a month to leverage the platform and try it out for yourselves. Thank you very much for having me here today.